Bonjour à tous. Hello, everyone. From coast to coast to coast, vaccination is underway. As of last week, we had delivered close to 1 million doses total to the provinces and territories. There's still a lot of work to do, but these shipments are already bringing relief and hope to communities across the country. Every day, more vulnerable people in long-term care homes and more healthcare workers are getting vaccinated. And in Indigenous and Northern communities too, the immunization campaign is ongoing. Last week, on Vancouver Island, 600 doses arrived for the Cowichan tribes. Within just 2 days, every single one had been administered. Over the weekend, 9 Cree communities in Northern Quebec received boxes of doses. And in the coastal Inuit community of Nain, Nunatsiavut, Canadian Rangers were deployed and did great work to support the vaccination efforts. This is what teamwork looks like. To everyone who's part of this effort, thank you. When we work towards a common goal, we get results for all Canadians. Now, even with this good news, the situation is still critical. Our fight is not over. That's why we have the plan Canada needs to get you and your family vaccinated as soon as possible and to deal with any roadblocks that come up in our way. For example, Pfizer's global supply issues are not ideal, but that's why we were so ambitious in the large numbers of contracts we signed and doses we secured. I can tell you that Minister Anand is in contact with the company every day. Remember, this situation with the Pfizer delay is temporary. Our vaccination objectives for the first quarter of the year, January to March, are not changing. And the total number of doses committed to us is still the same, with every Canadian who wants to get vaccinated able to get vaccinated by September. Quand je dis que tout le monde doit faire sa part, je m'adresse aussi aux voyageurs. C'est pas le temps de voyager à l'étranger. Si vous aviez prévu de quitter le pays, s'il vous plaît, au nom de tous les Canadiens, annulez. Ça vaut pas la peine d'attraper la COVID-19 et de la ramener au Canada pour un voyage dans le sud ou ailleurs. Comme vous le savez, les voyageurs doivent faire une quarantaine obligatoire à leur retour et les conséquences sont très sévères pour ceux qui ne le respectent pas. Quant aux nouveaux variants de ce virus, que ce soit en Angleterre, au Brésil ou en Afrique du Sud, on suit la situation de très près. Mais une chose est certaine. Avec ces nouvelles mutations, les circonstances pourraient changer très rapidement. Alors, encore, on demande aux Canadiens de rester ici au pays. Surtout que de jour au jour, les ministres continuent d'évaluer les différents enjeux et on pourrait imposer de nouvelles mesures sans préavis, dépendamment de la situation. Plus que jamais, pendant la pandémie, nos choix personnels ont des conséquences sur la sécurité et la santé des autres. Continuons à être vigilants. Il faut continuer de s'entraider. Quand on ne respecte pas les consignes, ce sont les travailleurs de la santé et les plus vulnérables qu'on met à risque. Mais souvenez-vous, la situation est temporaire. Les vaccins sont en train d'être déployés. Il faut tenir bon pour les prochains mois, parce que, tout comme vous, j'ai bien hâte à l'arrivée du printemps. It is absolutely critical that everyone keeps doing their part to slow the spread of COVID-19. We owe it to ourselves, to our families, and to everyone around us. Vaccines are coming. In a few months, spring will be here. So now is not the time to abandon our efforts. I think of the tragic and unacceptable situation in long-term care facilities in Ontario and across the country. Our parents and grandparents deserve better. Our nurses deserve better. So to the residents, we are doing everything we can to get you your vaccine as quickly as possible. And to the workers, I know your families are worried as you are worried about them. I know that your kids are afraid to lose you every time you go to work and you're afraid of bringing home the virus. So if you haven't already received it, we're getting you your vaccine as soon as possible. So thank you for everything that you do, your dedication, your commitment to Canadians impresses us all. There's a lot more work to be done, but we're making important progress. Last Friday, Mayor Watson here in Ottawa said that all long-term care homes in the city have finished their first round of vaccination. In Quebec, 3/4 of long-term care home residents have had their first shot. More doses are coming, and we won't stop until everyone is safe. Alors que des mesures plus strictes pour freiner le virus ont été annoncées par plusieurs provinces dans les dernières semaines, beaucoup de gens continuent à s'inquiéter pour leur emploi et pour l'avenir. Notre gouvernement a mis des programmes en place pour vous aider et nous allons être là pour vous tout aussi longtemps qu'il faudra. Pendant la retraite du Conseil des ministres, l'équipe s'est penchée sur notre stratégie pour continuer de soutenir les familles, les travailleurs et les entreprises. Pour nous dresser un portrait économique national et global, nous avons reçu la présentation de deux experts, Kevin Milligan de UBC et Francis Donald de Manulife. Et nous avons aussi parlé de la relance. As Canada recovers from this global crisis, we want to make sure that everyone, every worker, parent, and young person lands back on their feet. To help do that, part of our strategy is ensuring that Canada becomes the global clean tech leader, and that Canadian workers be at the forefront of that vision. On that note, it's great to see that Unifor members ratified their agreement with GM Canada to build battery electric commercial vans here in Canada. Including this agreement, deals that have been announced over the past few months have secured nearly $6 billion of investments in the Canadian automotive sector. These deals are protecting and creating good middle-class jobs, and they're creating new opportunities right across the country. With these investments, Canadian automotive workers and businesses will continue to lead in growing markets for efficient, electrified, and smart vehicles. Like we said when we presented our climate plan, a healthy environment and a healthy economy, clean technology presents enormous opportunities for economic growth and jobs. When a project is good for workers, for growing the middle class, and for protecting the environment, everybody wins. There's still a lot of work to be done to rebuild a stronger, cleaner, and more inclusive economy, and announcements like these are exactly what we need to get there. Before we end today, I'd like to say a few words about this week's inauguration in the United States. Tomorrow, Canadians and people around the world will be watching the swearing-in of President-elect Biden and Vice President-elect Harris. This moment will mark a new chapter in the incredible relationship between our two countries. I also want to address reports surrounding the Keystone XL project. Yesterday, I spoke with our ambassador, Kirsten Hillman. We've had a clear and consistent position supporting this project for years. Our government is making sure that Canada's views are heard and considered by the incoming administration at the highest levels. And of course, I'm really looking forward to working closely with the new president and his team to create jobs and build back better for us all.